To River House by Gianluca Arrighi, narrated by Patrizia Barrera, published by TEKTIME. Copyright. No part of this publication may be reproduced, stored even with electronic means, or transmitted in any form, or by any electronic mechanical means, including photocopying, recording, or other means, without the prior permissions of the rights holders. All rights reserved, right to publish and print, right of translation of the work, right of making the work available in electronic format, right of recitation and fixation, right of processing by transformation into a dramatic work, right of processing by transformation into a screenplay or other adaptation for cinematographic work, audiovisual or television work. Rights holder, Gruppo Mea SRLS, info@gruppomea.it. Dedication to the great lawyer Leonardo Casu, loyal and a brave friend. Part 1. Chapter 1. Biagio Martini landed under the gazebo in the expensive garden of his 3 million euro villa, a glass of Yamazaki whiskey's favorite in hand. To the outside world, it was the epitome of success. A renowned civil lawyer, happily married for 15 years, father to 2 bright and beautiful daughters, and the head of a travel law practice that had just expanded to include 5 attorneys under his leadership. At 45, Biagio appeared to have it all. His wife sat beside him, serene and content, while their daughters laughed and played on the lush grass. Yes, this idyllic scene masked a darker reality known only to a few. Emma's wife, from a certain point, perhaps his sister Delia, also she must have seen him as the worded, and of course, Biagio himself. That's why he had already consumed half a bottle of Yamazaki and felt an urgent need to drown himself in the rest. It explained his irrational fear of thunderstorms, as bad as with depression, panic attacks, and the first migraines that left him with the temporary gaps in his memory. Biagio had spent 35 years navigating the corridors of child psychologists, psychoanalysts, and mental disorder specialists. He often felt, like that evening, on the brink of an implosion if he wasn't careful. The root of this torment traced back to Maurizio Martini, his father, a man who had raised him without a shred of affection. Elisabetta Bacco Martini, his mother, played the last role in the familial tragedy that haunted him. He wondered if what he felt was self-pity, a sentiment he generally eschewed. His real regrets were for his family, especially Emma. His daughters, still young and resilient, were sheltered from the darker aspect of this past, yet devoured to spare them the toxic family environment he and Delia had endured, a promise that he largely kept. Yet the girl was intuitive. They sensed their father's struggles, glimpsing the shadows that occasionally crossed his face. They deserved a better father, and he loathed himself for his shortcoming. Emma, too, deserved a better husband. How she had managed to cope with his neurosis for 16 years, always supportive and confident, was beyond his comprehension. Biagio sipped his whiskey, the weight of his hidden light pressing down on him as the sunset began his picturesque but deceptive appearance. Biagio Martini watched his wife under the soft glow of the gazebo lights in the sparkling garden. Emma was the pearl of strength he desperately needed, nurturing him when he was fragile, reprimanding him when he strayed, always playing her part flawlessly, or at least driven to. She was his lover, his best friend, his confidant, the very glue that kept his fragmented self from shattering. With Emma and their daughters by his side, he believed he could conquer the demons that haunted him, just as Dr. Pasotti had always encouraged. Yet, supporting him had exacted a heavy toll on Emma. Gone was the carefree joy that once lit up her face, replaced by premature streaks of grey through her rash blonde hair and a wrinkled edge in her delicate features. Over the years, she had even battled a dependency on hashish, a struggle she had overcome through sheer willpower. Biagio loaded himself with the burden he placed on her. Despite his relentless effort to suppress his darker impulses, he often faltered. His deepest fear was pushing him to a breaking point, fearing she might leave him and take their daughters, Greta and Vittoria, with her. Without them, he was certain the demons would finally tear them apart. Turning to Emma, he observed her tranquility as she watched her daughters play. She still radiated the beauty that captivated him the night they met at the dinner party. The taste and connection had quickly led to marriage. Now, looking at the story, the mix of love, the sigh, guilt, and something akin to a prayer within him. Emma caught his gaze and smiled knowingly. "What's up?"
"Nothing. Just watching you."
"And what are you thinking about?"
"About how much I love you."
"I love you too, very much," she replied, then added with a hint of playfulness, "Ah."
"What does ah mean?"
"I think I know what's going on in your head," Emma said, her smile turning challenging, yet her eyes remained soft. "It must be the Yamazaki talking."
"I don't think I have that much. Anyway, you are the one who gets lovely with whiskey."
"Shh! Keep your voice down." He smiled sincerely, adding,
"You are a wonderful woman, Emma."
"I know," she teased, tracing her fingers along the tendons in his wrist. The moment was shattered by a shout from the lawn. Greta and Vittoria were at it again.
"Mom, Vittoria stays with me," Greta cried out.
"That's not true," Vittoria retorted.
"Yes, it is. She made me sleep on the ground. Look at my elbow. It's bleeding." "It doesn't bleed at all, cry baby. I tell you it is, and it's what you made it bleed,"
Emma said. "I better go check on them. Those two little demons should have been in bed long ago." He nodded, watching her navigate the cobblestones with grace, then down when the last third of his whiskey in one gulp. In mere moments, Emma had the quality of the sibling squabble, a thing yet gentle approach coaxing the girls into temporary truce. They switched the taxis, tried to chant their way out of bedtime, an utterly ritual. "No stories tonight," Emma commanded, shoving her in then towards the house.
"In 10 minutes, I want you in bed, tit brushed, lights out."
A command was final. Unlike Biagio, Emma wielded authority with this, ensuring great compliance from their daughters. Biagio, with his lenient and indulgent nature, often let the girls bend the rules. This had once been a source of friction between him and Emma, but she had since taken the reins when necessary, smoothing over any potential conflicts with the practice at ease. Returning to sit beside her husband, Emma noticed that Biagio's refilled glass. She said nothing, but her eyes conveyed a clear disapproval. She disliked seeing him drink so much.
"Is everything okay, sweetheart?" she inquired gently.
"Why do you ask?"
Biagio responded, a hint of defensiveness in his voice.
"You seem upset."
"It's just work. The new lawyers and I are dealing with some complex appeals,"
he lied smoothly. The truth was far from his professional life, and Emma, despite her support, couldn't penetrate the depths of his current turmoil.
"Do you want to talk about it?"
"No, love, I don't feel like it," he muttered,
taking another sip of his Yamazaki, which suddenly chased the beater. He set the glass aside, pushing it away with a sigh.
"Why don't we go to bed?"
he suggested, his voice dropping to a suggestive whisper.
"It's only 9 o'clock,
Emma replied, trying to play for my target at her lips.
"Bed.
Bed,"
Biagio repeated, a smile widening into a mischievous grin.
"Ah, I understand,"
Emma chuckled, tousling at her care seductively.
"Okay, but let's wait until the girls are asleep."
As they prepared for bed, Biagio couldn't help but admire Emma's figure, outlined perfectly by their tight white pants. His desire for her was palpable, a testament to their 16 years of unwavering fidelity. Yet, amidst these familiar feelings, a dark impulse surfaced. A sudden, inexplicable craving not for his wife, but for Fiamma Lorenzi, a lawyer at this firm.
This new year was sinister, a stark departure from a lover affection. It was raw and blood at the last, seeking not to cherish, but to conquer.
Chapter 2.
Darkness. Then the pain to clouded mind. Sometimes his sound fade away like the pain, and then all that remains is a sense of confusion. Before the confusion, I remember the darkness, total darkness. In those moments, I have no idea who I am or where I am. Flashes of dreams, images, and memories seem to come from other memories. Little specters hover in the darkness, with empty and fearful eyes. The world is a vile place, a place of salt, ash, and blood, a place where people hide from their children's eyes and give up their dignity for a life of relentless pain. Women and men wield knives, guns, and claws to give voice to their fury. There is always in the soul a morbid conflict, a struggle between disgust and need, between light and darkness. I keep my eyes closed, and I wander with my thoughts, searching for something either in my mind, suffocated by suffering. Perhaps I wish to die in the case imbued with pain that fills my head like a stormy cloud. When I begin to regain clarity, I remember that periods of pain have a cyclical rhythm, and soon the light will rise. I repeat to myself, like a mantra, that the darkness of the mind often travels dark path, but there is nothing to fear. In every scary place, something beautiful will eventually grow. This awareness, at times, is comparable to relief.
Chapter 3. The October sun, warm and inviting, baited Agata Rubino's journey in a golden glow. Perfect waiter for the endless miles stretching before her. The rhythmic hum on the engine, the wind whispering secrets through the open window, the steady tram of tires on asphalt, and the crackle of old favorites on the radio, these were the companions of a relentless quest. With each passing kilometer, a sense of needing her objective intensified. Focus was paramount. She couldn't afford to falter, couldn't let hope flicker and die. This wasn't just a journey, it was a homecoming, built one long day at a time. A phantom image flickered on the sun-deep blue windshield. Tanilo, her husband. His tan skin, the phantomless depth of his blue eyes, the silky caress of his brown hair, a wave of melancholy waved over her, tightening the grip on the wheel until the aching air jaws subside. The longing for Danilo was a constant ache. Moments like these, where love, distance, and the yearning intertwined, he could create the fastest route back to Rome. Just a glimpse, a touch, a whisper of reassurance, a promise that everything will be all right, that she will fix it all. The temptation to turn back at the surface at the countless times, only to be wrestled down after a few precious hours. As they she maintained the contact with his parents, Gabriele and Valeria, phone calls to the clinic were a conscious avoidance, the knowledge that the doctors wouldn't divulge information over the phone a constant deterrent. Letters, penned regularly, were her lifeline, along with the occasional call to his allows. Moment was crucial, a constant pushing forward. Tanilo wrote to 3 or 4 letters a month, even thought he might not be able to read her replies for a long time. But the act of writing was a necessity, a testament to his love. When he recovered, this letter would be a chronicle of a journey, a testament to her unwavering efforts. He would know, deep down, that she never stopped thinking of him, not for a single moment. And so she wrote, sending her letters through Gabriele and Valeria, ensuring they would always find their way to him. This wasn't just a trip. It was a resolute pursuit to reunite with Danilo. Every clue she followed, every leader she chased, bridged the distance between them. It was a thrilling suspense novel, each twist in the road a potential revelation, every letter a piece of a large puzzle she desperately needed to solve. Each envelope was marked confidential and personal, a silent promise that its contents were for Danilo's eyes only. She trusted Gabriele and Valeria implicitly. As his parents, their honor was unquestionable. As the gas station loomed ahead, its a signet and a cluster of parked trucks beckoned there.
If you'll go too deep, the precursor will be low, mirroring the ground resuminating in from my stomach, an handful of dried fruit that money wasn't enough. She slid off the highway, pulling into the service station, and followed the bar of her car and her own anger. Stepping into the adjoining restaurant, she was met with a scene familiar to seasoned travelers, truck drivers huddled around the counter and the tables, a fellowship forged by the open road, no matter the length of their journeys or the size of their rigs. The once male-dominated domain of truck driving was undergoing a metamorphosis. Women were increasingly taking the wheel, challenging the status quo. It was a demanding profession, not for the faint of heart. Grueling cadres stretched from pre-dawn stars to destination hundreds of kilometers away. The industry itself was in flux, with the transport companies succumbing to closure in recent years. Yet, the pink wave of female drivers continued to swell on Italy's highways. These women, with their diverse backgrounds and perspectives, formed a vibrant community. The Buona Strada Lady Truck Driver Team was the beating heart of this community, a virtual space where women, current drivers, those who once drove, and aspiring newcomers, shared experiences and advice. Truck driving was more than just steering a behemoth down the highway. It required the mastery of road sex, meticulous road planning, the ability to perform basic maintenance, and the logistical finesse to manage cargo operations. Two long hours often meant to sacrifice time with the family, and she was fortunate. And Danilo shared a partner who not only understood these challenges, but championed her every mile of the way. To rest a bustled with the truck drivers, the starless nomads of the highway wrecked their countless miles with an almost joyful resilience. Agatha envisioned her own return to a normal life soon, rejoining a joyful time. Her employer at Europa Transport and Logistics had assured her a spot whenever she was ready. Very rambling, she approached the counter and snagged the attention of a hard waiter. A ham and cheese sandwich, a mineral water, and a steaming cup of coffee materialized in front of her. Reaching into her funny bag, she retrieved her phone and opened the photo gallery. On the screen, a grain image captured from security camera, a man's face. Agatha showed it to the waiter. He barely spared it a glance before muttering an apology and dashing off to other patrons. Dejected, Agatha looked at beside her. A fellow trucker, a friendly face framed by static snake tattoos on her neck, caught Agatha's eye. "Buongiorno," Agatha greeted with a small smile. After exchanging the pleasantries, Agatha took a chance. "Bene chance," she began, showing the photo again. "Have you ever seen this man?" The driver scrutinized the image, rolled forward. "Not sure," she admitted. "The quality isn't great." "It's been ahead with some forensic software," Agatha explained. "Like on those crime dramas," Agatha chuckled. "Exactly. So, does it ring a bell?" "Can't say that I do." "Is someone you know?" Agatha shook her head. "Not exactly. Family?" The question hung heavy in the air. "Someone I need to find," Agatha finally replied, her voice tight. The trucker's gaze sharpened with curiosity. "Why are you looking for him?" The answer burned on Agatha's tongue, a bitter counterpoint to the coffee now warm in her hands. She pursed her lips, averting her eyes. The reasons were hers alone, a sacred pact with the man in the photo.
Chapter 4. She had resumed the journey in her car, finding solace and comfort within its familiar confidence, much like she did in the truck. The sense of calm had begun years ago, when her father permitted her to drive the old fair Ducato in the Clara near the house. How old was she then? 13, 14. Nearly 2 decades had passed since that time, during which she had driven a variety of cars, from good ones to wrecked jalabes. There was the 1995 Peugeot 106, with its unsettling flutter that cut her from pushing it beyond 90 kilometers per hour. Then came the 1998 Lancia Epsilon, a one-octane colored vehicle with a bent half shaft that made maneuvering almost impossible on bends. And then there were 4 or 5 more recent models, leading up to the 2020 Alfa Romeo Giulia, which enacted Canadair luxury with its blend of leather and metal.
She adored that car. It was reliable, sleek, and had yet to present 10 issues, at least until then. The Amazons of the Asphalt. This was how truck drivers referred to women like her, professionals in road transport, who excelled when behind the wheel. It was a fellow truck driver who had coined this unusual term for her. Agatha, unfamiliar with the expression, had looked it up and found some articles. A grown-up psychologist suggested that road Amazons used their vehicles as a means of escape from the stresses of daily life, similar to how others turn to movies, books, or hobbies. By isolating themselves within their vehicles, they created a sense of vulnerability that they temporarily kept their troubles at bay, allowing them to assert control over their destinies as they did over their vehicles. These words stuck with Agatha over the years. The psychologist has struck a chord. Travel made her feel invincible, capable of facing any challenges, and it helped her stay strong after what happened to Danilo. One thing the article hadn't touched upon was the sheer physical pleasure Agatha experienced while driving. On warm, fragrant evenings, she sometimes felt a stirring sensation, even finding herself in a state of arousal. Whenever on bustling highways or quiet country roads, the location mattered little. What counted was the feeling of being part of mystical mechanism of well-being while driving. During their first date with Danilo, she had attempted to convey some of those sentiments, albeit without delving into specifics. Upon her return to Rome after delivering a load to Milan for Europa Trasporti and Logistica, she encountered him while entering the appliance store ordered by Gabriele and Valeria to purchase a new flashlight. The one she had in the truck was starting to malfunction. Danilo worked alongside her parents, and their family business was driving people may have forsaken many things, but certainly not the latest generation computers or smartphones. A mutual fondness had sparked instantly. Following the sale of top-quality LED flashlight, Danilo had extended an invitation for a coffee from the store vending machine, eventually persuading her to go out with him. On their first outing, he had taken her to Fregene, to a familiar restaurant. He had chuckled upon hearing an anecdote about the asphalt Amazons. However, this had no jerk there in the slightest, quite the opposite. The moment she heard his gentle laugh, with his head slightly tilted, accentuating the contours of his profile, she comprehended her love for him. It was a realization that struck her instantly. "I show you," she had responded, and she had indeed shown him. Not long after, he not only became convinced, but also embraced her word. Before and after tying the knot, they often ventured out for drives together, taking turns beyond the wheel. They would frequently indulge in passion within the car or in the back of the truck, revelling excitement and the fun key to adolescence. Yet, this was merely one aspect of her admiration for Danilo. Beyond that, she admired his openness to new experiences, his acceptance of her without endeavoring to alter her. Danilo. The name lingered in the whispers of the wheels. Danilo. Tears welled up in her eyes. With tears came reflections. The ache of longing to be with him intensified to the point of almost unbearable solitude. One day, she affirmed to herself, she and her husband will be reunited. One day, she repeated in a choked out cry. Chapter 5. As Emma wrapped her legs around Biagio's hips and whispered, "Slowly, Biagio," a familiar tension crept into his back. In the soft glow of their bedroom, that word was her usual refrain during their intimate moments. Emma was not one for words in bed, no tender phrases, no playful banter, just that single cautionary whisper. It was a way of signaling when he needed to temper his past measures, a reminder woven into the fabric of their 16 years of marriage. That evening, however, the demand felt like an intrusion, something of pleasure for the moment for Biagio. He felt reduced, not like an husband or lover, but merely for continually performing a task. His mind wandered, images of Fiamma Lorenzi invading his thoughts, vivid, provocative. Overwhelmed by rational selfish desire, Biagio changed his approach abruptly. He moved without usual care, driven by an impulse greater than intimacy, reaching a swift and solitary high point followed by Emma's soft murmur of discontent. Typically, a lingered, maintaining their connection momentarily even after his own pleasure picket. But not tonight. Tonight, he withdrew quickly, a dismissive pat on her hip, his only parting gesture, before he rolled away. Lying on his back, Biagio stared blankly at the ceiling and his breathing slowly, these thoughts settled. A wave of shame washed over him. He had acted tartlessly, driven by a fleeting desire rather than the deep love he felt for Emma. It was then just to project his frustrations onto her. Turning to face her, he reached for her hand, his voice soft and remorseful. "I am sorry, my love. I don't know what came over me tonight." Emma's response was brief, her tone cool. "It's all good." But her words were tinged with dirt, a clear sign she was more affected than she let on. Biagio felt the sting of her subdued reaction, recognizing another scar left by his carelessness. "Let's not talk about it anymore, okay? Let's sleep now," he suggested, hoping to ease the tension. He had aware that some words needed more than silence to heal. Biagio remained there, distant from his wife, trying to smother the whirlwind of child's reason through his mind. It was as if he was harboring a cancer inside him, a genetic cancer of the soul, the disease of Maurizio Martini, his old dear dad. He had tried to ignore it for 35 years, another of his pathetic efforts, and all that time, the cancer has spread metastasis everywhere, to the point where now it could see it exactly for what it was. Impossible to deny what one saw with their own eyes. Biagio Martini was his father's son.
Chapter 6. After leaving the highway for Parma and navigating several roundabouts, Agata steered onto the provincial road, following Sank's pointing towards Brescello. As she drove, she pondered whether she had visited this part of Emilia-Romagna before. She was familiar with the most areas, except some mountainous regions of the Apennines, sparsely populated and remote. Yet, she knew she would explore them eventually. Suddenly, the reason Brescello rang a bell dawned on her. The town was famous as the famous location for the beloved Don Camillo and Peppone films, based on the stories by Guareschi. This old-fashioned comedies, cherished by Danilo, possessed a timeless charm accentuated by their black and white cinematography. Glancing on the sky, tinged with the hues of dusk, she estimated the time to be around 7 in the evening. Her extensive experience of driving day and night had a whole ability to tell time of the sky's appearance, a useful skill for someone who spent so much time on the road. Brescello, nestled in the heart of the lower Reggio Emilia region and bordered by the right bank of the Po River near Lombardy, presented a charming prospect. Should she choose to stay, she would need to find a place to live. Fortunately, the past 4 weeks' work, transporting goods for a food company based in L'Aquila, had been lucrative, providing her with sufficient funds to consider renting a cozy apartment in the town center. Agata couldn't recall any personal memories of Brescello apart from its connection to the Don Camillo films, and this lack of recollection suggests she might never have visited the town. With so many cities across the regions, it was challenging to call them all. Initially, when her explorations were confined to Rome and its surroundings, the task seemed more manageable. But as her travels expanded into Lazio, Umbria, Abruzzo, and Emilia-Romagna, the endeavor grew increasingly complex. At times, Agata felt as though she had traversed every municipality in these regions, though she knew that it was an exaggeration. Perhaps she had visited half, or maybe even fewer. With many towns sharing similar or identical names, it was nearly impossible to keep track of them all. Feeling the onset of fatigue, Agata knew it was time to rest. She needed to find a secluded spot, a park, a country lane, or a spacious parking lot, where she could pause for a few hours undisturbed. Once settled, she would plan her next steps for the following day, ready to continue her search anew. Chapter 7.
The first call that morning in Biagio's studio was from Fiamma Lorenzi, a voice that always managed to stir a complex wheel of emotions in him, a mask and discomfort with the veneer of a casual professionalism.
Good morning, Fiamma. I was thinking of the prestigious Fabrizio and Lorenzi. His voice carved a hint of unease, despite his best effort to sound nonchalant.
Oh, well, thank you, Fiamma responded, the tone smooth, almost velvety.
You seem a bit subdued today, Biagio. Is everything all right?
No, he lied.
Ever since fine. What do I have the pleasure of this call?
Just a few things, she replied, with deliberate vagueness, her words hanging in the air like a eternally veiled challenge. Fiamma, a formidable criminal lawyer known for her darkness and lack of pretense, was a part in a Delphine Reggio Emilia, specializing in tax offences. Her film often leaned on Biagio's expertise for civil cases. She had never been shy about her interest in him, adding a load of complexity to their professional relationship. After the pause, she added,
"Okay, for starters, I need an update on the Santis appeal. We should have it wrapping up by tonight. I'll confer with Erika and get back to you," Biagio said, stalling for time. "Still there?" "I'll call you back shortly," he promised. "Don't take too long. I'll be in my office all morning," she said commandingly, before ending the call.
Biagio walked down the hall to Erika Tofani's office. Erika, his right-hand woman and the cornerstone of his practices, was deeply involved in legal maneuverings and documents management. After updating on the appeal, she inquired him,
"Why didn't she call me directly? Was there something else?"
"Just the appeal," Biagio responded, trying to keep his voice even.
"Nothing else?" Erika pressed, a tone suggesting she knew there was more at play. "There's nothing." "What are you implying? Do you really need to explain it to you?"
"No."
"But why do you dislike Fiamma so much? She's a predator, Biagio. She'll chew you up if you're not careful," Erika warned, her voice tinged with concern.
"It's a mark like that," Biagio defended, taut a part of him wondering if Erika might be right.
"Be careful," Erika said, peering over her glasses with a mix of skepticism and concern.
The pressure at the Templars grew as Biagio returned to his desk. It tossed a tumultuous storm. Fiamma's frequent visits, their lunches, their long conversations, they could easily be misconstrued by someone as observant as Erika. Committed to his wife, Biagio had no intention of an affair, yet he couldn't dismiss the nagging feeling that Erika might know something about Fiamma that he didn't. Fiamma was well connected in Reggio Emilia, mingling with the elite. The economic benefits of their first collaboration were undeniable, yet Biagio had never heard anything overtly negative about her, despite the rumors that swirled around her personal life. He considered scheduling an appointment with the doctor Elena Pasotti, a renowned psychoanalyst in Reggio Emilia, to discuss his unsettling thoughts about Fiamma. His last session had been 10 months ago, and thought he found Dr. Pasotti somewhat cold and imposing, her insights had previously helped him navigate complex emotions. As he contemplated the graduate with his family to escape the brewer's dark within, the idea of the boat trip seemed like the perfect escape. A brief respite from his demons and the looming winter that always darkened his mood. Resigning to the impossibility of a gateway, Biagio turned back to his immediate concerns. He picked up the phone to update Fiamma on the appeal, inadvertently inviting future complication.
"Do you need anything else, Fiamma?"
he found himself asking, a question that opened doors he had intended to keep closed.
"Actually, yes. How about a drink after work?"
Fiamma's voice was inviting, a sinus call that he knew he should resist.
I don't think that's a good idea, he stammered, his resolve wavering.
"Meet me at the Café Latino, 7 o'clock.
It's just a drink, Biagio," she coaxed, her tone both a challenge and a promise.
Against his bad judgment, he agreed, "Okay, at 7. As he hung up, a chain ran down his spine. He had stepped into a game that might be more perilous than he had anticipated, under the watchful eyes of both Erika and Gertrude's storm clouds.
Chapter 8.
It was 9 o'clock in the morning when Agata woke up in the parking lot of a supermarket in Brescello. Her first stop was a self-service laundry. Her clothes were dirty, and she was beginning to smell. Now when she needed to make a good impression she was to look for work, she cleaned herself up. After laundering her clothes, Agata visited the first bar she found on Tomei Street. She had breakfast, consisting of two brioches and a cappuccino, and took the opportunity to freshen up in the restroom. By the time she left the bar, it was just past 11. Her search began in earnest in the nearby commercial area, bustling with the restaurants and the shops, and eventually led her to a shopping center. There, Agata approached anyone she called, salespeople, customers, newsagents, and the cleaner staff, showing them a smartphone with a photo of a man's face, asking if they recognized him. The replies were uniformly negative, accompanied by head shakes or puzzled looks. Some people reacted with a lot of curses, eager to distance themselves from her, casting nervous glances over their shoulders as if she were a pursuer's reader than a solitary man asking for help. Feeling crazily isolated, as though she were hit up a skyscraper reader there in a crowded shopping center, Agata continued her search through the streets of Brucello. It was in the early afternoon when a tall, thin young man with a touring person on his lower lip caught her attention. His reaction to the photo was different. His eyes flickered with recognition.
"Do you know this man?"
Agata pressed him, but she denied it, attempting to leave quickly.
"You know him,"
she insisted, grabbing his arm. This was no longer a question.
"No,"
the young man protested, claiming a momentary false recognition.
"I thought I did, but I was mistaken. Please tell me the truth,"
Agata urged, sensing the importance of his initial reaction.
"I don't know him,"
he repeated, pulling away and escaping into a car, which he drove off rapidly. Unable to follow immediately due to her car, Julia being parked too far away, Agata could only notice direction. She hurried to Julia, drove in the direction the young man had taken, and after about 30 minutes, arrived in Reggio Emilia. She parked outside the restricted traffic zone, ZTL, and eventually into the historic center on foot. In a larger square, luckily in front of the town hall, where a small fountain featured the state of a birdman holding a vase, Agata resumed her inquiries. But just as before, no one she approached recognized the man in the photo, nor did she spot the boy with the persons. Despite the lack of a concrete leads, something about Reggio Emilia stirred in her a faint yet persistent hope. She decided to spend the night there, thinking that if this hopeful feeling persisted, she might start looking for work the next day. Agata had been aimlessly wandering the square for hours, occasionally pausing to sit at the cafe table and sip a crudino. Each time someone passed, she would rise, frame in hand, hopeful yet met with indifference. As the sun dipped below the horizon, a chill settled over the square, nudging her to resume her search with renewed urgency. Just as she contemplated her next move, a struggling woman with the flowing red hair caught her attention. She appeared to be in her early 30s, frequently checking her phone as if awaiting someone's arrival. Agata, feeling the ache in her legs and the twinge in her back from hours of fruitless endeavor, pushed herself up from the table once more. Perhaps this woman would recognize the man in the frame. However, before she could approach, a man appeared from the upside end of the square and made his way directly towards the red. As they met, Agata froze. The man's face was unmistakable, the same face that had haunted her dreams, the face she had seen every day in her relentless search. It was like a physical blow, a surge of adrenaline shot through her heart pounding wildly, a temperous throbbing. She thought she might have let out a moan, but if she did, it went unnoticed by the couple. Fred had linked arms with the man, and then began to walk away. Agata stood rooted to the spot, overwhelmed by a storm of emotion, excitement, hatred, contempt, all swelling together tumultuously. It was him, the man in the frame, the very man responsible for Danilo's suffering. There he was, just a few steps away from her. There was no doubt in her mind, no room for error. He was the bastard she had been hunting for so long.
Chapter 9.
Fiamma's playful jab hit Biagio like a July-eyed punch. Quite the charm, Biagio, she drawled, a hint of amusement laced with something else in her voice. He blinked. The prosecco was momentarily eclipsed by a prickle of unease.
What do you mean?
The woman by the counter, Fiamma said, leaning in closer. A perfume, a usually comforting scent, took on a strange intensity in the dim cafe latino. Her hand landed on his, a seemingly casual touch that sent a jolt through him. Doesn't she look familiar? Biagio's gaze darted around the room, finally landing on the woman Fiamma described. Tall, athletic, with the first intensity in her eyes that seemed to bore straight into him. She was a stark contrast.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.